A friend of mine asked me if I wanted his old iMac to play around with. Sure, could be fun. This is one of those too old to be useful, yet too young to be retro kind of machines. Could we make it useful again? Let's find out. So, what to do with this thing? It still boots into macOS El Capitan, but it's slow as fuck. Also, El Capitan hasn't been in support for 7 years by now, so it's not really a good idea to keep using it like this. macOS shows me that this is an iMac 7.1 from 2007, rocking a Core 2 Duo CPU, 4GB of DDR2 memory, and an ATI Radeon HD 2600 GPU. Nothing to write home about, but it should be enough for some basic desktoping, right? Let's try to boot it into Linux. I pick Endeavor OS, because a little bird told me that it includes the B43 driver and firmware, making Wi-Fi work out of the box. That's usually the hardest part on old Macs. Wi-Fi indeed works right away. Cool! We can browse the big bad interwebs and watch TechDweeb videos. What more does one need? FastFetch agrees that this is an iMac 7.1 rocking a Core 2 Duo T7700 CPU. Inksy shows me that we're using the Radeon graphics driver. No Vulkan data available. Yeah, this card is old enough to not have Vulkan support at all. Right, before installing anything, I'm going to replace the slow hard drive with an SSD. It's an easy task, but it takes some work to get to the drive. First, we need to take the glass panel off, which is held in place by strong magnets. You can use suction cups for this, but I don't have any, so I'm using duct tape. Woohoo! Next, we're going to remove no less than 12 Torx screws to release the front part of the body. Crap, forgot the memory cover. That has to go out first. I don't think you actually need to remove the memory modules, but better safe than sorry, right? Obviously, there was no way they could make all screws the same length, right? I placed them in the order in which I took them out. Now tilt the front bezel, but beware of the little connector at the top. I found this pointy thingy about halfway next to the screen on the left side, but I can't seem to find where it should go. It does look a bit like the two that are on the bottom side of the bezel, but more shiny? Drop a comment if you have any idea where it came from. The fan seems a bit dusty, but other than that, it looks pretty clean in here. The next thing to do is to release another 8 Torx screws to remove the display. It's connected to the electronics inside by no less than 3 cables. One at the lower left side, which comes off quite easily. One at the lower right side, which is screwed in place using another 2 Torx screws. And one at the top, which is easiest to disconnect from the panel itself, because it's connected at the back of what I think is the power supply unit. Well, that's our hard drive. I turned the machine around, so you're looking at it upside down right now. The drive is at the top part of the iMac, next to the power supply, which, by the way, is fully exposed, so be careful not to touch it when you work on one of these. The drive is in a bracket that just clicks into place, so we can unclick it. Peel off the temperature sensor that's stuck onto it. Not sure if it's the case for this model, but some Macs will turn on the fans at full force all of the time when this sensor doesn't register anything. So we're going to stick it onto the SSD when that's installed. Right, so there's pins on this side of the drive and a plastic clip at the other end. I'm going to remove that and put my SSD in a 2.5-inch to 3.5-inch adapter so we can reuse those. This is the SSD I'd like to install. Let's put in the adapter first. Add the pins from the old hard disk and the plastic bracket, which I apparently did slightly off camera. It clips nicely into place. Oh crap, The SATA cable is too short to reach this SSD. Always something when working on Apple hardware, but yeah. The hard disk is indeed a few centimeters longer. So instead, I removed the bracket and just put one screw over here to hold it in place. It is what it is. I guess an extension cable might be neater, but I don't care enough to buy one. Let's stick the temperature sensor onto it. It's not that sticky anymore, so I need to fix that. But first I want to know if it works at all. Connect the screen again without putting any screws in. Turn it on. That doesn't sound good. Maybe it requires that connection on the bezel?
Nope.
Oh crap, I took the memory out. Let's put one stick back in.
Hey, victory.
Manjaro! Yeah, this is the SSD from my previous video, and it works. Turn it off and disconnected the screen and bezel again so I can undust the fence. Took it outside, but there was a little rain, so I put it in the garage with the door open. Took some double-sided tape to put over the temperature sensor and stuck a piece of foam on top of that, which also came from the old hard disk. This way it will at least not hit the display, I guess. I blew some air through the fence and venting holes to clean it up a bit. And took it back inside. By the way, as mentioned before, this is the power supply unit of this thing. And there's some big capacitors at the back of it. Don't touch this, you'll regret it. Here we have the Wi-Fi module, so you could very easily replace that if you wish to do so. I think this is the Bluetooth module. Not too sure about that. There's two memory slots, which are both utilized with 2 GB sticks, which I believe is the maximum supported on this thing. These speakers sound pretty bad, as you might have noticed earlier. Not sure if that's just because they're old though. Here's the optical drive, which I guess you could replace with a SATA SSD adapter if you don't need it, but don't take my word for that. Let's close her up again. I installed the B43 firmware package, which is kinda hard to see because the screen is filmed too bright. Sorry for that, it'll get better in a minute.
Ta-da.
A reboot later, Wi-Fi works on Manjaro as well. Nice! I have installed Vulkan SW REST, which will provide Vulkan support in software. Probably a bad idea, but let's try it anyway. Steam is still on here from my GTX 660 video. Can we play Dredge using DirectX to Vulkan translation? Yeah, playable as fuck. I don't think you should even consider this. While we're in Arch-flavored land, let's give CachyOS a try. What desktop do we want? UK UI is a lightweight desktop environment. Cool, never heard of it before, so let's try that one. Installation went fine. Alright, let's install some games. Interesting. This package installer seems to be little more than a wrapper around the terminal. Let's set a nice wallpaper. I kind of forgot that I had zoomed in to show you the package installer. Okay, games. SuperTox feels kinda slow at 1920 by 1200. 1280 by 800? Still a bit sluggish. At 1024 by 576, yes, you heard that right, it seems to run decently. Oops, skill issue, I guess. SuperTox card, 1280 by 800 and FX level 2, perfectly fine. Could we set the FX level at 3? that's a bit too much. T-Worlds, I don't know this game, but it was in the repo, so I installed it. Local? Oh, is this multiplayer only? Let's try this one. I usually don't do this because I don't want to mess with anyone's online game for a test like this. How does this game work? Oh, I'm stuck. let's try another game. Well, at least it seems to run well. It seems we've been playing at full 1920x1200 resolution in high detail, so there's that. Xenotic, another game I never tried before. This one does have single player mode. Phew! That's a tad too much, but what settings do we use? 1920x1200. Let's first turn off anti-aliasing and anisotropy. Nah, that's not enough. Kinda as expected. 1280x800? It's a tad better, but still not great. Maybe disable OpenGL 2.0 shaders. I'm not sure this card even has this capability. Way better! Cool! Deathmatching against bots. No one to bother with my crappy skills. Cool! I need to remember this game. 0AD doesn't run at a great frame rate, but I guess it's good enough for a game like this. I'd say it's better to keep the higher resolution in this case. How about Sauerbraten? 1920x1200 resolution and these settings. Seems pretty decent. Of course, we can do Linux games without even trying TuxRaiser. So here's Extreme TuxRaiser doing... okay. A tad stuttery here and there. Lowering the resolution doesn't really seem to fix that. I figured I'd see if Mango Hut could provide some info, but the frame rate seems fine, and although it reports a GPU doing nothing, I think that is due to the Radeon driver just not reporting anything because the CPU is not breaking a sweat at all. Even back at desktop resolution it seems fine, but feels stuttery in corners. I tried some settings in the ini file, but nothing seems to fix the stuttering. Until I tried to raise the field of view from 60 to 80%. That seems to raise the average frame rate and gets rid of most of the stuttering. Before you ask, CachyOS's game performance command didn't seem to make any difference. One last thing before we wrap this one up. Putting anything else than macOS on these old Macs makes booting pretty slow. It seems like it really wants to make sure there really is no macOS available on any disk before it will try to boot anything else. This results in a boot delay of some 45 seconds before we even see the Linux bootloader. You can fix that by booting from a macOS installation medium and run the bless command in the terminal. So we can use diskutil-list to show the available disks and partitions like this, to find the EFI partition on our SSD, which is disk 0S1 in this case. Now run the command /device /dev/disk0s1/setboot/verbose, and of course change disk 0S1 for whatever the identifier of your EFI partition is. Less than 14 seconds from pressing the button to CachyOS's crop screen. That's quite an improvement. Another downside of using one of these as a Linux PC might be power draw. Idle on desktop in CachyOS, it uses around 120 watts. Running Xenotic, it hardly goes up, hovering around 130 watts. So power management on these things kinda suck on Linux. I tried to find a solution for that, but failed. I think the CPU simply will not get into a lower power state, as this line seems to suggest. If you do have a solution, please share it in the comments. I couldn't find one. So how feasible is it to use one of these as a desktop computer in 2025? Well, if you still have one around, I'd say it might be worth it. On Linux and with an SSD, it's still a pretty decent machine for basic desktoping. And as you saw, a little bit of gaming is still achievable for sure. Just don't expect to be able to open your Steam library and play everything. The power draw might be a bit high on Linux, which is a real bummer, but do take into account that this is for a full system, including the screen. For reference, the 24-inch monitor I'm using to edit this video on pulls around 29 watts from the socket right now. The 1920x1200 resolution of this iMac might not be something to write home about in 2025, but it's still one of the better looking ones out there. That's all I have for you today. I hope you liked this video. Thank you very much for watching, and thank you, Erik, for giving me this. Until next time.